You learned about the bias variance trade-off in this lesson and the last lesson. Now I want you to hear from Sean. Hear about his work at Facebook and pay careful attention to his models and the trade-offs and the visualizations he made.
Some recent work I've been doing on measuring fan sentiment for NFL teams over the course of the season that I'm really excited about. It's been a really fun project because I myself am an NFL fan. I'm a huge Eagles fan, and I go through all the emotions that a fan goes through over the course of the season. You know, the highs of when your team wins, and then the lows after a couple losses in a row of feeling kind of hopeless. And so I got the idea of maybe we could measure this and kind of tell a story, not just for my team, but for all the other teams in the NFL, and come up with some idea, some way of visualizing this experience of being a fan. And so I counted ratios of positive to negative words at 5-minute increments over the course of the whole 4 months of the NFL season. And because we're taking a ratio, we end up with some measurements that are extremely high, like, you know, positive to negative word ratios of over 100, even though the average is somewhere in the 2 to 3 range. So this was kind of like a first cut at the data, and we could see that there's some signal here, but it's definitely going to need some modeling or some statistics in order to kind of tease out what's actually happening. So the next step that I did was just compute a moving average of these 5-minute measurements, and we start to get a little bit of signal out of there because we're pooling over more measurements, so the measurements themselves are more reliable. And we end up with a series that kind of tells a little bit of a story, but these measurements are still too frequent and too noisy to really tell a story about what's happening. When we aggregate it up to 1-day moving averages, we start to see some patterns emerge. I guess one of the key features of this data set was that I knew what I was looking for ahead of time, because I am an Eagles fan. I experienced the highs and lows of the seasons. I can look at a plot like this immediately and tell you this is not telling the story that I want. We needed to maybe apply some modeling to that. We want a model that predicts sentiment as a function of time. And then one of the things that comes to mind right away is a natural spline. You can see this actually tells a nice story. These colored lines are the dates of wins and losses. It kind of gives you an idea of why the lines are upward sloping or downward sloping. So you see here kind of like the exuberance at the beginning of the season as people are really optimistic, and then, you know, 3 losses in a row, and you see how the sentiment dips. This tells a nice story, but it doesn't have the feature of that we'd expect, which is that on game day, things change really abruptly. At the very end of the game, when you know if you've won or you've lost, you're much happier and much sadder than you were at the beginning of the game. So we expect to see really discrete jumps in sentiment that we don't see from a model like this. And this is because this is a bad model of the underlying data generating process. So we need something more flexible. One way to do that is just to use a 7-day moving average, which is going to allow us to include only kind of the last game's sentiment in the moving average. So we're going to take a moving average like I showed you before, but smooth it out into over a whole 7-day period. And when we do that, we get something that actually tells a really nice story about the season and has all the kind of characteristics that I would expect as a fan and having gone through this, which is the kind of the big bumps up on game days where you win, the big bumps down on game days where you lose, and then kind of these plateaus in between, which are these periods of stability. When you don't have any new information about how your team is doing, we see the a week off around Thanksgiving, but then there's this big spike in happiness because people are just happier on Thanksgiving. This big low point right after a loss that could have knocked them out of the playoffs, and then a big kind of ascension into their playoff game, which they ended up losing, and it's kind of the subsequent dip. This, I think, is a really nice depiction of what happened, and it just took a little bit of averaging to get this story to come out.
When you're looking at all this data, what sort of things come up for you in terms of bias and variance trade-offs?
When you're computing just a simple moving average like this, you're dealing with one of the most, it's just a really flexible statistic, and so you're not imposing any structure on the data, you're letting the data kind of speak. When I use a moving average here and I plotted standard errors that were kind of rolling along with the data, they were gigantic. The mean sentiment for the season is somewhere in the 3 range, and the standard errors were over 2 or 3. We can say very precisely what's happening at any given point, but our variance on that estimate is huge. So as we started to add more lags, a higher number of lags to the moving average, we end up with kind of smoother looking plots that have lower variance, but then are getting progressively more biased. So as we go back further, we're including more data and we're getting more biased because we're including data from parts that actually aren't applicable to that exact point. But in exchange for that, we get a lower variance plot, one that doesn't move as wildly. When we combine that with splines, we can end up fitting a model that has kind of the best of both worlds, which has the smoothing aspects of the splines with the discrete jumps of what happens on game day. And so this is a spline where we add in dummy variables for post-game periods. In this model, we end up with kind of all the same things. We get the big jumps that we expect, so jumps down on losses, jumps up on game days where they win, and then also kind of the smooth transitions in between. So it was kind of a nice story of taking one style of model, which is a spline, which is just too specific for the data generating process and maybe not a good fit, and then doing some exploratory data analysis where we see that averaging over 7 days tells a really nice story and gives us the discreteness that we want, and then combining those two together into kind of an aggregate of the two types of models where we're able to better account for the fact that game days are an important thing.